Grace and peace, grace and peace. This is Brother Minister Everett Hakeem Gillum L. of Agape Speaks Outreach, also the author of Think and Grow Godly Rich, the anthology, which you can find on Amazon and Kindle at your leisure. I want to come to you guys today and first and foremost say thank you for all joining in. This is the day that the Lord has made that we shall rejoice, be glad in. I am so glad to be amongst the land of the living, having God's life, breath, and health. I'm so glad to also be amongst the chosen, who is the chosen of God, which we know in the scriptures as Israel. So I give all praises to God. I give all honor to Jesus, Yeshua the Christ. And I thank the Holy Spirit for being in us to have us begin to live, move, and have our being. So I want you guys to take part of this 2021, 21 days of godly success as we are on the 14th day. So I want to also say thank you and congratulations for those who have endured thus far. Remember, the Bible says that the race is not given to the swift, but it is given to those who endure to the end. That end we know not, because the Bible also tells us that no man or woman knows the hour nor the time of God. So we must prepare ourselves. We must always be ye ready and able for God's will to take place in our lives and transform our heart, minds, and souls and be reconciled back to the Father. So I want to talk to you guys today about the 357 rule. The 357 rule. So give me the opportunity to invite in some friends, family members, loved ones, as well as foes. And I also encourage you to do the same thing. If you can do me a favor and hit that like button, as well as hit the share button. Hit the share button so that you can share this live Facebook Live over to someone that you know that needs to take part or needs to be encouraged or be edified, as the Bible talks about being edified in the body of Christ. If you know somebody that needs to have a makeover, if you know somebody that needs to begin to understand what it is to move from religion to a relationship with Christ, if you know someone that is struggling with their walk, you know someone that's been harmed or hurt by the church, if you know someone who feel like they're about to give up, then I encourage you to hit the share button so that you can share the good news with your family members, friends, loved ones, and foes. As we go in, I want to share this broadcast out, so I thank you guys for joining in. So as I am sharing, I ask you to do just the same, and we're going to get this out to as many people as we can so that people can be inspired in this time that we're in. We're in a challenging time, some may say. We're in a perilous time, some may say. Some say we're in the last days. But what I want to know is that we're in these last days and these times, are we preparing ourselves? Are we setting ourselves apart so that God can get the glory out of the life that he gave us the time to have, if it's our time to go beyond with the Father? And so what we got to do is we got to make sure that we are preparing. We got to make sure that we are examining ourselves to know that we have studied God enough, we've studied his word enough, that we have proven ourselves to be fit for the kingdom. And so I want to give you guys the opportunity, again, like I said, to share this broadcast with someone you may know. So hit the like button, hit the share button so that someone can get the gospel, someone can get the good news, someone can be edified in the body, someone can be inspired to live out what God has created them to be here on earth before they were yet in their mother's womb. God fashioned us. He prepared us. He designed us. He shaped and molded us in the very nature that we are in so that we can grow back to the Father. I say grow back to the Father. So if you know someone that's ready to grow back to the Father and take part in these 21 days on the 14th day as we're on of 2021 godly success, if you know someone, I encourage you to go and share that button. And so I'm going to give you a few moments so that we can go into a moment of worship. We can get ourselves together. We can get our spirits together. We can get our minds placed on him, because we have to be transformed by the renewing of our minds so that we can comprehend in the spirit what God is trying to say. We can comprehend in our soul as we begin to be healed and made whole again from being broken. Because most of the time, Many of us are broken, or many of us have been harmed or hurt in our soul, where our mind, will, and emotions is. But God said he wants to take out of us the stony heart and put in us a heart of flesh. That heart is a heart of Christ. That heart is the heart that Daoud had when he was seeking to be a friend of God, when he was looking for a friend. If you are friendless, if you're looking to have a friend who sticks to you closer than a brother, if you're looking to have someone who will not leave you nor forsake you, if you're looking for someone who you can lay and have your burdens laid upon where you can find rest, then I'm encouraging you to seek ye first the kingdom of God. Turn your minds, turn your hearts, turn your lives to the Savior, for which you will gain your help, because he came that you may have life and life abundantly. So as we go on to this, I want to pause and give us this moment of worship so we can go in and be at the throne of God. We can be at the presence of God. Just where you are, you can be right there. You are the church, the temple of the Most High God. So let's go into this for a few seconds. Yes, God. Yes, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lay your life, your strength, your favor. Lay your hand upon us, oh Father. Touch us in areas, Lord, where we need renewing. Heal us where we hurt, Father. Work on where we've been wounded. Shape us, Lord God. Feed us, Lord God, where we're in starve. Where we hunger for your person, your presence. Where we hunger for just the enlargement of the territory that we have been given. Fill us, O Father. Father, you say if we ask, we shall have. You say, Lord, if we seek, we shall find. So, Father, we come right now seeking your presence, your purpose, our passion to be fulfilled in the mighty name of Yeshua, Jesus the Christ. We thank you, Father. We give you all praise and honor, Lord God. We worship you with our words, will, and our hearts. Hallelujah. Yes, God. Father, build us up where, Lord, we can become leaders in the kingdom by following those who have led before us. We can walk in the footprints, Lord, that were clearly cut by the great apostles and prophets of the old. Those who came to America, Lord God, and paved the way. The great ones, Lord God. We honor each and every one of them. We honor Malcolm X. We honor Martin Luther King. We honor Megar Evers. We honor Sojourner Truth. We honor Prophet Noble Drew Ali. We honor the Honorable Marcus Garvey. Hallelujah. We honor Ashaka Musubar Shango. Yes, God. We honor the Khalid Muhammads, the Elijah Muhammads. Father, we honor all those who have came to at least change the minds, the slave mind, the victim mind, that they may be renewed again. Father, you said that renewing starts in the mind. And so, Father, we thank you, Lord, that we can have the ability and we can have the fortitude, Lord God, and be granted the privilege, Lord God, by you to turn and renew our hearts and minds as we seek the kingdom, as we acknowledge the resurrection of Yeshua, Jesus the Christ. We know what he has done, we shall do, and even greater. Father, we thank you for being about your business, but not forsaking the assembly, for not forsaking those who are in need, for not forsaking the widow and the orphan. For you said in your word, this is true religion, to not forsake the orphan and the widow. And so, Father, we fulfill this calling by turning our will and our hearts and minds over to you, that we can be made in agreement with you. And we cast down all vain imaginations, Lord God. We cancel out all debts, all agreements that we have made with the enemy. For how heaven has opened up, Lord, we thank you that we can yield our spirits and our hearts and minds to you, and you can remake us over again to be the mere creation of what you've created us to be, to resemble the reflection of your holy resurrection here on earth as it is in heaven. For Father, we thank you for leaving us a counselor of all truth, Lord God, that will not lead us into the wrong, but direct us into the right. We thank you, Lord, for being a part of the percentage of people that it has the countenance of God and that's been chosen by God. So, Father, make your home in our homes. Make your presence in our very makeup. Let us love instead of hate. For the kingdom law is love. And we shall fulfill that kingdom law. For Father, we know that your son, Yeshua HaMashiach, did not come to do away with it, but to fulfill the law spiritually, that we can begin to love. And love covering all sin. We thank you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So let us go on into our lesson. Let's go into our lesson as I invite others in. Please do the same in the name of Yeshua. We thank you. Yes, God. Hallelujah. 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 Yes, God. Right where you are, worship. Right where you are. Worship him. Right where you are, worship him. Right where you are, worship him. Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Yes, God. All right, let's get into this lesson really quick. I don't want to hold you guys long, but I want to hold you strong enough to actually have the change that God wants to do on us in these 21 days. So as God is beginning to continue to work on us, I know that there will be a blessing. There will be something that you can take from this to add to what you already have, know, and what God has already bestowed upon you. And so what I want to do is I want to talk about the 357 rule coming out of the book of 1 Corinthians. Chapter 1, verse 10. And we want to talk about this 357 rule, because this 357 rule is the rule that we would need in aligning the measurement of our walk with God and our ministry. This 357 rule is a number that will measure us and show our reflection in the scriptures. It will show us that when we're working towards becoming leaders in God, that as we become leaders in God, we reflect in the Word of God where it says that we have now become disciples so that we can continue to go and make disciples. So if you've been with me on these last 14 days, or these last 13 days, today is the 14th, on this 21 day of godly success, this 21 day of godly success is a makeover. It's a new you resolution. It's where you put off the old man and put on the new man. It's where you become a new creation in Christ, because he is in you, the hope of glory. It's where you start reflecting and start agreeing that when you were created by God, for God, that you are now beginning to learn how to do the will of God. The same as what Yeshua said when he was on the cross. He says, Lord, not by my will, but let your will be done. So what we're doing in these 21 days is learning how to actually be about the Father's business. We're learning how to go into the Word of God and allow the Word of God to become alive in our lives, so that we don't allow it to be a religion and just some mere practice of something we're doing just for public viewing. But we're doing it because we want to make the Spirit of God become known and felt in our own experience. Because man knows not by being told. If man must know, he must be what he knows. And so if only thing you know is the memorization of the scriptures, but you have not experienced the spiritual touch of God, you have not experienced the spiritual understanding of God, or you have not obtained the wisdom and the knowledge that Solomon obtained, then you need to research, or you need to return. You need to tesuvia. You need to repent, change your mind, re-examine yourself, and find out how you can study to show yourself approved. So this is the help and the assistance that God has given us through the book Think and Grow Godly Rich, which I authored, which you can find on Amazon. He's given us the blueprint. He's given us the steps, the divine instructions, so that you and I can basically get past of all the practicalities of flipping and jumping through hoops. We can get past all the practicalities of being the ideal intellectual property of man, and we can cross the borderline at will. See, God removed everything that is in the way of you. And so you don't need nobody else to really show you or tell you how to do this. Only thing you have to do is be still and know, as the scripture says, that I am God. And if you know for certain, if you have ears to hear and eyes to see, you'll notice that when you say that scripture, when you repeat that scripture, it's an affirmation where you put in yourself in the place. You've actually put yourself in the scripture, because you have to say, be still and know that I am. The I am is the declaration before everything that you actually profess out of your mouth. Okay, you said the video is not playing for you. Okay, I'm not sure why, but maybe you need to go out and come back in. Maybe you need to go out and come back in. I know you are across the lands, so maybe that could be the situation as well. But I pray and trust that you can get in on this live, because I want you to receive it. Because I believe that God has put you on this live so that you can receive it. So if you can go out and come back in and see if that does any grace for you. But as we're going on, we have to understand that the 357 rule from 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 10, we actually learn that the apostle had to make certain steps in order for the measurements. Because when we talk about 357, we're talking about calculated steps. The calculated steps of a man. The Bible tells us that the steps of a man or a woman is ordered by the Lord. And so we understand that the steps of a good man or a good woman is ordered by the Lord. And so when we know that we're in the steps or the footprints of the Lord, we're in the footprints of the Messiah, then we understand that we're making calculated steps. And these calculated steps are measurements, as I believe is called 357. And these 357 measurements is the 357 rule for you and I to actually come into the principles and practices of being disciples to make disciples. Okay, so listen, as we go in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10, excuse me. The writer says, "Now I plead with you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all speak the same thing." That all speak the same thing. So God wants us all to speak the same thing, because we are all in the body of Christ and we serve one God, one Lord, and we all should have one aim. So we shouldn't have double talk. We shouldn't have conflict. We shouldn't have discord, because if we're all in the spirit, we're all in the kingdom there's harmony. In the kingdom of God, there's peace. There's happiness. There's joy. There's love. So we understand when we move into the kingdom mindset, when we move into being kingdom citizens, then we should all speak the same thing. We should all have the same view. We should all be on one chord, where God knows that when he moves in accord. He moves like an army. He moves in one accord. And just as the army move when they're going in for infantry to go in to scout the land and everything, they move in unison. And so what God says that when we're making calculated steps as to being disciples of God, to go and make disciples, then what we do is we're working together on the accordings of God where we can go forth and we can what? We can scout out the land. We can scout out the provisions of what God wants in our life, and we can begin to remake ourselves into one body. Because remember, we're serving in the body of the Most High. We're serving in the body of Christ. And so in order for us to receive the godly success that the world calls success, is that we have to work in unison. We have to have the same language. So it says, and that there be no division among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the name, in the same mind, and in the same judgment. So as the scripture says that we should all be in the vein. We should all want to be changed. We should all be on one accord in this new era of time in 2021. We should all be seeking to have the attainment of godly success, the favor of God, the provisions of God, the blessings of God. And so when we are in that same vein, then we understand that no devil, no demon, nothing outside of God's perfect will can come in, because we have fortified the perimeters, because we know the calculated steps of the number 357, because it's a rule. And when there is a rule to that perimeter, we understand that which is unruly or that does not go in accordance to the rule of measurement in God's order, then we basically remove it. And so he says that you be perfectly joined together. To be joined together is to be in the body of Christ. It's to be the members of the body. In the book of Corinthians, it says that he gave a different administrator. So we know that you may be good at one thing, and he may be good at one thing, or she may be good at one thing, but we come together, as I always say, we form like Voltron, because we know we have one aim to achieve, and that aim is to what? Seek God's kingdom, and that his kingdom be what? Brought here on earth through you and I, which is through love. The greatest commandment is love. Bible says that love God with all your heart, mind, and soul, then love your neighbor as you love yourself. So when we actually take these two laws and we hang all the laws of the prophet on them, the greatest thing as the kingdom's law is love. So we have to love one another. We have to love one another in order for God's will to manifest, in order for the law of the Spirit to be manifested and be moving in our life, that we can begin to be able to have the countenance of God reign upon the earth, where people are drawn in because they see the love, they see the union, they see the joint body, they see that there is no kind of severity. I learned in our real estate school that severity means that there's just one. But God is calling the body of Christ together to form that we can perform his perfect will. So the writer wants us to understand that the church of Corinth, they provided Paul with one of his greatest challenges. And so many of you will be provided with a great challenge, because anything that is challenging the rule of God, anything that's challenging the order of God, anything that's challenging the circumference of God's circle, or that which is breaking in, God says that it's a challenge. But just as the writer was challenged in the word of God in Corinth, we understand that he was forced to confront several problems, which we know that when we are called by God, we will be forced to go up against certain challenges. We'll be forced to go up against that which we were once a part of. We will be forced to go up against where we find comfortability at in our own convenient way. We'll be forced to actually be able to see ourselves going outside of the brick and mortar instead of just sitting behind the closed walls and allowing someone to preach and teach to us, and we just sit there and just listen. God wants to make disciples. And these disciples must begin to examine themselves to make sure that they're in the union in the body of Christ so that we can go out and make other disciples. Because God never sends them out in one. He sends them out by twos. He sends them out by crews. Because the Bible tells us that the witnesses, there were two witnesses that will bear witness of the scriptures. So there's always to be a witness according to the word of God. And God will always give us a witness in the word of God. It's called line upon line, precept upon precept. So when we talk about the 357 rule, how does that rule measure to my life? How does that fit according to my life and my work of living? How does that fit according to how I'm to be changed and made over? Beloved, you have to have the 357 rule because the Bible tells us that we are to be ye transformed by the renewing of our mind, and that renewing of your mind is being transformed by the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. 357. The three is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The five is the five numbers and the stones that David had to slew the giants of his life. The stone of grace, the stone of favor, the stone of faith. And the seven is where God begins to see that you are made perfect because you fell in accordance to the 357 rule. You fell in accordance to having the unions of God. You fell in accordance to where there was no more serpents coming in your hearts and your minds so that you can be dissevered, or you could be in severity of God instead of the union of God. So we have to be made over. We have to put aside the religions. We have to put aside of the things that has caused us to not think and grow godly rich. The things that has caused us not to be in the body of Christ, where we are imitating God on purpose eternally and not imitators of the world or imitators of the things that God has not provided for us. So this is called being ye transformed. This is called being ye made over. This is called dying to yourself, because in order for you to live in God's will, in order for us to be of God's vein, of God's tree, of God's vine, we have to be made over. There are some things that we got to die to. And so you might try it this way. You may have tried it that way. You may be tired. And so when I'm tired and, you don't know what I've been going through. You don't know who've been telling me this and who've been stressing me and pulling on me and trying to do these things. You don't know, but God says that he knows. And he says that if you come unto me, oh, you are heavy and laden and burdened, I will give you rest. And if you come into that oneness, if you come back into the calculated steps and orders of the Lord and you walk in his ways and his word, then you will be made over. So this letter that Paul had received, it challenged him to confront the problem. Some of our problems are challenges that God has allowed for us to confront the problem. Some of the things that God has allowed you to overcome is because he wanted you to confront it. He allowed you to go through it so long and so much because you need to confront it. You need to confront the addiction. You need to confront the effects that the addictions and the things that has been a stronghold on you. And so Paul confronted it. And he knew that his letter could have been a long letter. He knew he could have verbally spanked them. Because they were challenging his authority. They were challenging his presence for what he was there to bring. He knew he could have spanked them because he had God on his side. But he made it short. And he says, I'm going to give you a 357 rule in principle. And this 357 rule in principle is where Paul saw that the church had potential, but despite of its problems, he practiced love. God knows that in spite of your problems, there's potential in you. God knows that in spite of your stubbornness, there's potential. God knows that in spite of your addiction, there's potential. God knows that in spite of your need, there's potential. There's potential in you. And so he gives you the 3-5-7 rule. And this 3-5-7 rule is one, a principle where we're finding that the three people that should be more important in your life are the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, because now you're in agreement that your mind, body, and soul is in atonement with him and them. And so we find that the percentage of people that will actually agree and affirm to this 1% of the 3-5-7 is where we find that they will affirm that they'll speak and they'll reach and they'll teach and they'll love like God. They'll be willing to change. They'll be willing to sit and study and show themselves approved. They'll be willing to learn and not lean onto their own understanding, but acknowledge him, and he will direct their path and their way that they can become the dear children of the field. And so while Paul knew he must confront the issues, he began his letter with words of appreciation. Did not God so love the world that he gave his only begotten son to show that his appreciation was greater than what you would ever be able to give him? And so he gave his appreciation. And we know that in leadership, we know that when we are called outside, when we're picked or called to be set apart from amongst them, when we're called to be set apart from amongst those who don't want to align themselves, those who don't want to be a part of your life or your friend or your want to walk and work with you, then you have to basically cut these individuals off because they're not in accordance to the principles and the rule. And so God wants us to understand that we can't be bound by religion. We can't be bound by what the church has spoken and said to us throughout the times of being conflicting and having us to do these things and do this things. The Bible says faith without works is dead, but we understand that it is impossible to even please God without faith. So we should be increasing our faith more than we increase our work. And so we understand that a lot of the ministry and churches today, they want you to perform their works. And they want you to perform their works, and they want you to perform their works, and then they want you to have faith when it's time for you to receive the reciprocations of what you have put out. That's not word. We're talking about being kingdom-minded. We're talking about being kingdom citizens. We're talking about being citizens in the kingdom where we're all reigning and ruling supreme under the mighty hand of God. And so we have to understand that the number one affirmation comes before a confrontation. So we have to affirm a thing. We have to make the provision of confronting the thing before we can actually heal the thing. We have to confront to say and know that, yeah, I am a sinner, but I need to be saved by grace. We have to confront and we have to make the affirmation that, send me, Lord, I'll go. We have to make the affirmation that, Lord, I'm ready to think and grow godly rich. We have to make the affirmation to say, Lord, I'm ready to imitate you and not the world. And so once we confront their problems, then we can heal and be made holistically whole. So as Paul confronted the problems of the Corinthians, the people began to still seek to see people began to humble themselves, and Paul began to see the good in them. So Paul began to see the good in them because he knew the potential that they had. They just needed to be they just needed to have the calculated steps in order. They just needed to be placed on the right path. There's a lot of believers. Many are called, but few are chosen. The word of God tells us that many are called, but few are chosen. Many are professing to be of Christ, but they're not walking in Christ because they have no identity of knowing that Christ is in them, the hope of glory. They have left Christ in the brick and mortar, and they've gone home. And they can't wait to get back to see him on Wednesday and Sunday. When Christ says that I will not leave you or forsake you, I will not leave you comfortless, meaning that you have to understand who you are and whose you are. You have to understand your divine makeup. You have to understand that you are a mere creation and a type and shadow of the Most High God. You have to understand that there's great potential in you. And when you understand that, then you'll understand God sees that potential to put you in order, to put you in alignment of him so you can be about the Father's business and go ye and make disciples. You won't be religiously bound. You won't be handcuffed to hell. And so, this thing that Paul saw in them, we have to begin to see in ourselves. We have to begin to see from the sight of God. And so we understand that when we're on the 357 rule, we are on the principles, and these principles can basically dictate to us how we move. This is called strategic planning. So what did Paul see in him? What does God want to see in us? God wants to see in us that we are enriched by God. How are you enriched by God? We're talking about godly success. You are enriched by God because you understand that the wisdom of God is the wealth that you need. You understand that the peace that surpasses under all understanding is God in your heart and mind, which makes you rich in peace. You understand that the enrichness of God is having the fullness of God thereof, and what? Having Christ in you, the hope of glory. Having understood the resurrection, that it was an example and it was a picture of what was to come to us even more and even greater. That we can live and begin to move and have our being as so. The 357 rule allows you as a disciple of God to have fellowship with God, where you have what? Christ began, he was the mediator. And now that he's the mediator and you are in him and he is in you, which is the hope of glory, now you and him can go into the Father at will. You can cross that borderline. You don't need nobody to tell you how to do it or tell you when to do it. You don't need nobody to impart or tell you that they are your fathers or your mothers or whatever this thing going on right now. Because why? We are brothers and sisters in the faith. And if you're in line, if you're on the calculated steps and order of God's 357 rule, then you can hear the Father. Then you can hear the Spirit. Then you can begin to move in unison. Because why? We hear God speaking. People of God, those same people will have a positive lifestyle, a positive mindset, and make the right decisions. They will make the right decisions. They will make the right positive calculated steps. They will not put their hands to that which is unclean. They will not allow their thoughts to be overtaken and hijacked by heteric. They will not allow their bodies or their lives to be interjected by the enemy, that inner me. So God looks for good leaders. God is looking for good disciples so he can go and they can go and make disciples. And when he looks for good leaders, he looks for good people that he can affirm his trust in and his creative word that was created in the beginning. And he can allow you to be about the purpose of what he created Yeshua Jesus to be about the purpose of. And that is to keep preaching the kingdom of God. So, beloved, we have to be preachers and teachers of the kingdom of God. But before we can be preachers and teachers of the kingdom of God, we have to be made over. We have to come into the presence of God, where God is actually saying and working in us. And so when God is working in us, we have to allow God to work through us. So, beloved, I want you to understand that this live, this 357 rule, is to establish rule in your life. It's to establish the order in your life. It's to establish the will of God. This 357 rule is to allow you to understand that God is calling each and every one of us to be made over, to be renewed, to repent, to turn, to change our hearts and minds, that we can align ourselves back into the perfect will of God, and we can go forth and become a mighty move in the Spirit of God. We can think and grow godly rich because we have aligned ourselves to imitate God and purpose eternally. I want to read something from my book, Think and Grow Godly Rich. And I want you to understand that. I want you to understand that you have to You have to take on the principles of integrity in order to be made over as disciples of Jesus. You have to take on the integrity of God. There was a question posed last night in a live that I was on. And the question was posed out as, what is a real man? My dear grandfather nicknamed me Man. And it took me years of my lifetime to understand what is a real man. And as I'm growing to grow godly rich, as I am growing to grow godly rich, and as I am learning to also imitate God on purpose and be a leader to make leaders in the kingdom that we can be set for discipleship and fulfill the Great Commission, I'm learning that in reading my own material that God has placed, that it's going to take the principles of integrity. So in my book, I wrote about the principles of integrity to apply and live by. And I want you guys, again, like I said, to invest in your own life and invest in yourself and get you Think and Grow Godly Rich while it is on the promotional sale, because it will go up. The price will go up, because too much is given, much is required, and a servant is worthy of his hire. And in Galatians 6:6, it tells us that if you receive good instructions from an instructor or a teacher, then it is your duty and obligation to repay the teacher and the instructor back by sowing back into their life. So in order for you to sow back into my life, I'm asking you to invest in yourself, that you can invest and grow in godly rich, and you can begin to receive the godly success that God intended for you and I to have, truthfully and scripturally. So I want you to understand that the principles of integrity, number one is loyalty. To be loyal. Loyal to yourself. To be loyal to yourself is to be loyal to Him, because when you're loyal to Him, you're loyal to what He's created you to be. So now you're being loyal to yourself. Two is being honest. We have to be honest with ourselves. We have to confront ourselves. We have to challenge, as the apostle said in the scripture, he was challenged to confront the problem. And so we have to be honest enough to confront the problem, but be dependable. Be dependable. Now let me speak on this. When we be dependable, we have an old saying that goes, be your brother or your sister's keeper. Become a shoulder someone can lean on, that you can comfort them. Because even Jesus says, what? Come unto me. He was dependable. And for you are to be a person that helps to build up another person, which is called leveraging someone else up to the level in where God wants us all to be on one accord. Where we can heal until a brother or sister is made whole and holistically holy. So that's number three, being dependable. Number four is be wise. Be wise as a serpent, but as harmless as a dove, according to the scripture. We have to be wise enough that we don't become hazards to other people's lives. And then five, we have to be harmless. We have to be so gentle with others that we won't harm them. That we will be not incapable, that we will be incapable of injuring them instead of healing them. We won't inflict onto them physical or mental or emotional problems. And so I'm learning that as I read, Think, and Grow Godly Rich, that the principles, the divine instructions that are written and laid out in this wonderful book, God has called you and I to invest in, so that we can become what God has created us to be outside of religion, that we can be made whole with a relationship with the Most High, and we can go back into religion and make others whole again, that they can become disciples of God and go and make others disciples. So I want you guys to take that with you and let us go and bear fruit. In the name of Yeshua, Jesus Christ, I thank you guys for your time, attention, and ear. And I pray that something was said to your spirit man that will be an assistance for you to apply the 357 rule. The 357 rule, I believe, can help not only you, but me. Because I have to learn just as you learn. So let us earn the kingdom of God together as we learn the kingdom of God together. Let us remake man back into the image in which he was made. Alright? So with that, peace and blessings, shalom to every one of you. I will put the link to Think and Grow God the Rich in the comment section where you can go and order your copy, hard copy, or your Kindle version. And for those who have already pre-ordered, trust and believe that I am still waiting for your order to come through the mail. I don't know what is taking place with the postal services right now, but I do know that they're backed up for some reason. Maybe it's because of the all the stuff that's going on up in Washington. But know for certain that I have not forgotten you, and I will bless you guys with a blessing of frankincense and myrrh, which is an anointing oil that was placed on Jesus at his birth. So I will bless you guys with a gift of frankincense and myrrh. And for those who may want to get them some frankincense and myrrh oil to bless their house, to bless their home, to bless their body, and they're going out in the marketplace, please feel free to inbox me or go over to 3 Kings Fragrances, number 3 Kings Fragrances, where you can order you your own fragrance body oil for your spiritual needs or for your casual needs. I do have fragrance and I have lotions. So feel free to join and go over to that page. And until we meet again, don't forget to set your notifications for when we come again with more spontaneous spiritual works of God and blessings.